Patricia, and thanks again to the OECD for inviting me for what is turning out to be a really interesting day. We've obviously had a session this morning, and in some ways this is a reprise this afternoon, but if it's as good this afternoon as it was this morning, it should be fun. Just because I like to vary things, I'll change my preamble from the one that I used this morning and explain that I'm an academic, but and so you'll have to excuse me if some of the points are a bit academic. But I am an academic who tries to make things sensible to lay people. I think that's very, very important for all economists. I think it's especially so for competition economics. And so if I could just spend 30 seconds, 1 minute at the beginning, contemplating this big, big question, which is what really drives me in my presentation today. What do we mean by competition? And if you think about it, suppose you're in a cocktail party somewhere, or alternatively, better for me, in a pub somewhere, and somebody is asking you, what do you mean? Okay, you study competition. What do you mean by competition? And I want to get over to either to that intelligent person, a lay person in the cocktail party, or somebody I'm trying to impress in a pub, what I mean by competition. I would say, well, look at the football championship. If you look at the German Bundesliga, it's not a very competitive competition because every year Bayern Munich win it and it gets rather boring. If you look at the French Ligue 1, it's not very interesting. It's not very competitive because Paris Saint-Germain always win it. If you look at the Premier League in Britain, in England this year, it's extremely competitive because 1 week it's Leicester leading, the second week it's Manchester United. One day in my dreams, it will be Arsenal again. And another week, it will be Manchester City. And another week, it will be Liverpool. The point that I'm making is that it's very competitive because there's a continual churn. One team starts to go ahead, then somebody else catches them up. And so it goes on. And I think my own view, anyway, is if you want to try and explain to a layperson what you mean by competition, it's a process by which there's forever change. People are striving to beat each other. And I think we shouldn't forget that. And I think any conceptualization of competition really should involve that sort of concept. Okay, that's the preamble. Now on to the presentation. Next slide, please. Okay, I'll start off at the beginning by saying what I think is fairly pragmatic about where we are at the minute. And then I'll spend most of the remainder of my presentation looking at things that I think we really ought to start improving. And when I say we, it's not the royal we, and it's not just the we of the competition authorities, it's the we of academics. So next slide, please. Where are we at the minute? Well, at the minute, there's a multitude of different ways of measuring competition, and many of these we will see appear on stage in the next few papers, the HHI and other concentration indices, either the level of it or the change in it, market shares, entry rates, churn or turbulence, which is the one that I believe is the key, the price cost margin of old, other profitability measures, and then some measures which I think are more interesting but also still flawed, and these are ones where you compare firms within industries as well as comparing across industries. And then there are another set of more qualitative ways of measuring to do with trying to gauge consumer or business sentiments. I won't talk about those today. Next slide, please. If you look at across all of the measures that I've just briefly listed, I think it's quite useful to have a typology in which one can fit them. And I think there are basically four defining features of an indicator. One is they are either structural, like concentration, for example, or performance, like profitability. They are either static, looking at what's happening at a point in time, or they're dynamic, looking at how things are changing over time. They are either based on firm-level data or industry-level data. And relatedly, that they either make inter-industry, between industry comparisons, or within industry comparisons, intra-industry comparisons. Now, I believe these are all flawed, but I think they all bring something different, worthwhile to the table, and that the logical way of proceeding, given that no one measure dominates all others at the minute, is to suggest a cocktail of these different types of measures. In an ideal world, one might get measures which capture each of these features and therefore build up a more holistic story. Okay, that's basically all that I've got to say about where we are at the moment. Next slide, please. What I now want to talk about for the rest of my session is where I think we really do need to make improvements. And this is not a criticism of any individuals, certainly none of the presentations today, but more a statement of where I think we are in our part of the profession as of now. I have three concerns, basically. One is the conceptualization. I think nearly all of the measures that we use don't really capture that dynamic essence of competition that I'd mentioned, that I was talking about in the pub or in the cocktail party. They're also more, to put the point more technically, they're also very ambiguous about identification, what exactly it is it that we are identifying. And also they're often imprecise about the direction of causality. Then there are more definitional questions, which largely relate to the sort of level of aggregation that we're making the observations at. And then there's the very question of what is the scope of competition. Invariably, the measures we use use industries, typically domestic producers in a particular industry. Well, competition doesn't take place in an industry, it takes place in a market. And in a market, it is rare, not impossible, sometimes happens, but it's rare to find markets where it is only domestic producers who are competing. There are typically also importers, especially from the British perspective, and multinational firms, but I think more widely than Britain. And I think we need to recognize those are extra participants in the market, as well as just the domestic producers who produce. So those are the rooms for improvement. Now let me develop them. And undoubtedly, being an academic, and this is the second time I've given this presentation, I will almost certainly waffle on and go beyond my time constraint. So please give me a 2-minute warning.
Will do.
Thank you. Yes, next slide, please. Conceptualization, what is competition? Well, I've hinted at what I would tell the person in the pub. Next slide, please. But now to fellow economists. First, a brief history lesson. I was brought up in the days when structure, conduct, performance, coming over the Atlantic from Harvard, was the big thing. And the basic idea was that where there is high concentration, this leads to soft competition, maybe explicit collusion, but more generally tacit collusion, and that would lead to high profits. So high concentration means little competition, basically. Then along comes a man called Harold Demsetz and other people. John has told me I mustn't talk about it as being Chicago, so I won't. These are people in the 60s. And they said, no, you've got it all wrong. This is a spurious correlation in the strict sense of spurious correlation. But both the concentration and the profitability are determined by a third factor, which is efficiency. And where we observe concentrated markets making high profits, this could well be nothing to do with market power or softness of competition, but to do with very, very efficient firms earning high profits because they're efficient and coming to dominate the market because they're efficient. So far from worrying about high concentration, we should rejoice in it. Well, these are two competing explanations, which to this day are relevant. How do we choose between them? The way that Demsetz suggested, and there's a lot of sense in it, is once one has looked at the industry level data, then look at the within industry level data and see whether there are differences between the firms in the industries in how profitable they are. If it's the efficiency explanation which is valid, what you will observe within industries, high concentrated industries, is that the bigger firms are more efficient and earn higher profits. The smaller firms are inefficient and will earn less profit. On the other hand, if it's a collusive story, then all the players in that market are benefiting, and what you will observe is that they all earn high profits, whether or not they're big. And there's a lot of credibility in that sort of argument, but the trouble with that is it's inconclusive, because once they get big, these efficient firms may remain big by embarking upon anti-competitive practices. And so you may well find industries where there are big differences within the industry in profits, but it's because of the practice, anti-competitive practices by the big guys. And far from being competitive, they are not. So what we really need is something beyond that. Next slide, please. But look for the next brick in the wall. I think we can come right much more up to date and talk about the work by many people, but particularly Thomas Philippon. I wouldn't say I necessarily agree with all of his conclusions, but I think there's a piece of writing, his book 2 years ago is one of the best things I've read for years. And I even read it on holiday in Mauritius, of all places. It's a lovely book and I recommend it to anybody. Basically what he said is that there is good concentration and bad concentration. And the way that you distinguish between the two is to look at how the firm's market shares are changing over time. Very much the point that I was making earlier on. And it's very much, although he doesn't use Schumpeter's name, it's very much a Schumpeterian notion of competition, which I like very, very much. And it's the idea that competition is a dynamic process which evolves. It never stops. It's evolving forever and ever and ever. It's a never-ending ebb and flow. Firms grow and then decline and maybe grow again. New firms come in and there is generally churn. And this is captured, I think, in one of, actually it's not in his book, but in one of the working papers behind Philippon's book, where he develops the idea of good and bad concentration quite well. I did myself contribute to this literature last millennium, which John was talking about being old, but I'm seriously old. I did a couple of papers with Paul Jaroski, who was then the chairman of the Monopolies and Mergers Commission in Britain, and Richard Caves as well, who was a great thinker in my mind. Next slide, please. And the moral is, in Philippon, but I would adhere to this as well, high concentration may indicate failing competition, in which case it's bad competition. But it may alternatively be the outcome of a process of intense competition, survival of the fittest, good, in which case it's good concentration. To distinguish between the two, we need to delve deeper into the market. To see whether the concentration is good, we first, maybe, this is me talking now, not Philippon, we first look at the significant differences between firms at each point in time. That's the Damsetian view. And indeed, it's the idea, the thinking behind the bone index that we've talked about this morning. I think maybe we'll appear this afternoon as well. But that's not enough. We need to go beyond that. We need to look for significant volatility in firms' market shares over time. And going back to the layperson, trying to explain to the non-economists what we mean, there's a very nice couple of papers by the Social Market Foundation in Britain, which looks at 10 case studies. And somebody asked me this morning, is it a good idea for competition authorities to focus on the big, large-scale statistical studies of the sort that we'll see this afternoon, or whether to go for a small set of case studies? I personally believe that they should be doing both. Now, what the Social Market Foundation did in a couple of papers was to look at 10 high-profile consumer product industries. And they looked at concentration and they looked at the volatility in those industries. And just to pick out a comparison of two of them, groceries, in that industry, there was high concentration, is high concentration in Britain. Telecom, equally high concentration. But in groceries, there's quite a lot of turbulence in the market shares. It's a very competitive market. Whereas in telecom, there was no such turbulence in market shares. The implication, although again, they don't use the terminology, is that in groceries, the concentration is good concentration, but in telecom, it is bad. All of my remarks here are about concentration and market shares, but the same sort of arguments can apply for profit. If you want to look at the measures based on profits and margins. How long have I got, Chair?
I was just another 2 minutes.
Oh, no. Can it be a sort of 2 minutes like it is in cricket, which lasts for 5 minutes? Next slide, please. Sorry, that joke won't be understood. Aggregation. Actually, can we go switch to aggregation? Because if I've only got 2 minutes, may we go straight through to, the slides on aggregation are all about the need to get to markets which are defined as antitrust markets rather than the sort of SIC industries that we tend to use in studies so far. The point being that in any SIC industry, there is typically 10, 12, whatever, separate antitrust markets, and the industry isn't necessarily representative of the markets in it. But I haven't got time for those, so I think it's the penultimate slide, please. The difference between markets, not industries. Yep, this is my last point. And this is the point where I want to stress the difference between looking at an industry and looking at a market. Most of the statistics we have are for industries. And the example I'm using, again, this is understandable for a typical person in a pub or in a cocktail party. If you look at the British car industry, there are six main manufacturers. Those are named there. Those six firms between them account for virtually all of the cars produced in Britain. They are all foreign-owned multinationals. Most of their production is not for Britain, it's for export. And they also have considerable sales and production outside of UK. They account, and this is the most telling of my bullets, they account for only three of the 10 best-selling models in the UK. The other seven best-selling models are imported. So what is the lessons for measuring competition in the UK car market? Well, concentration measured by production statistics are totally meaningless. Secondly, imports are not necessarily just a competitive fringe, which is how they were often characterized in many, many studies, especially when I was younger, but even today. They're not a competitive fringe that just comes in and competes at the world price. They are actually major players in the market. They potentially have considerable market power. And thirdly, intra-firm trade is important. So when we measure their scale in Britain, we're failing to understand that a lot of the value that they're adding is actually made outside of the country. And this may or may not distort considerably the figures that we see for their production, sorry, their turnover in Britain, and of course their employment. Often turnover in Britain includes, in fact, output produced in other countries in the same firm, which makes the turnover big, but their employment is small because it's only the employment in Britain that's considered. So you get these astronomic productivity figures, which are meaningless. Equally, the figures, in fact, for profitability in the British operations may be totally misleading. So I think we have a major data task to combine, and I think we really ought to be doing this now. This is what should have been done when I was a young man. It wasn't. People have failed down the decades now to combine trade data, meaningful trade data, with the sort of industrial structure data that we're talking about today.